Okay, we are live. Hi, everyone. Just
Hi.
going to wait for some confirmation here that we're live. We are live. Great.
All right.
Hi, everybody.
Hi, everyone. Welcome for our Facebook Live tonight. We are really excited to have the two minds that we need in this moment, Katie Moutaris and Kristen Zimke. They are co-authors of Read the World and Amplify, both fantastic books. And tonight we're going to really dig into their perspective and insight on what teaching and learning looks like with the integration of digital tools. So I'm going to actually just flip over my screens right now so that you can see them both. And we will go here. There we go.
All right.
Hello, so thank you, Katie and Kristen, for joining us. We're so excited to have you and really excited that you're here and really hoping that this conversation tonight will just give everyone a moment to exhale and have some conversation about, what we're into right now. And, you know, so what do we even call this right now? What are we doing right now?
We are on a great adventure, I think. But if you ask Katie and I, we would just say, like, what we're doing right now is learning. And, our belief from the get-go has been it's not about the technology. It's about what we're doing with it and how we're involving kids and how we're getting to know our students better through technology. So lots of growth has happened in the last little bit. But I think it's been a wonderful time for us to model learning for our students and to have those conversations when we say to them, like, I don't know, what do you guys think? Or, you know what, this is the first time I've tried this, but, like, let's go and see what we can figure out about this new process or new tool.
Yes, all of that. I also call it hard. Uh-huh. And that's okay, because we know that when things are challenging, where we are learning, our kids are learning, I can speak to the process from, from an educator standpoint, but also from a parent standpoint, because I'm simultaneously doing what many parents, those of us who are privileged enough to be working from home, are doing right now, which is working full time and juggling two small children, one of whom is doing e-learning, the other of whom is sort of just bumming around the house, making a mess. So yeah, like it's learning and it's messy, but it is kind of exciting. I'm not gonna lie. I think there's some possibility and potential that could come out of this very not good situation.
Well, and I think it's a moment where we need to pause and celebrate. Like, we know how important those celebration rituals are in the classroom with learning and accomplishing something new. We need to do that for us as adult learners, too. In a period of just a few months, we've, leapt forward years and years in where we were nationally on a digital front. And we can now see areas that we definitely need to grow in. But also just stop and celebrate and say, like, we tried something new. We did this. We're working on it. And we're going to keep, just like we do with our writing or readers workshop, we're going to keep refining it to do a little bit better next time around.
Yes. Teachers everywhere deserve a firecracker clap, right?
I love that so much. That's fantastic. So thinking along these lines, we really kind of just, we were all thrown into this because that is the way that it happened. But what are you thinking of in terms of the structures, teaching structures that we would need to teach, whether we are online, we're in a blended environment, we're back in the classroom, no matter what the setting is, what are the structures we need to be focusing on come fall?
That's a really good question. When we wrote Read the World, we focused on seven structures.
Seven structures
that we felt like really supported in classroom learning. And I think that a lot of those structures can transfer over to our digital learning atmosphere. You know, one of the structures that really guides us is that clear focus on students. Now is the time when we have to sort of strip away all of the extra and really focus on our kids. What are we seeing, both academically, but also social-emotionally, right? What are they telling us about what they need in this moment and what they're ready to learn next? So, Kristen, you want to talk about some of the other stuff?
Yeah, and I think, like, you know, going along with that, we start with students always. You know, we teach the reader, not the reading, and then we look at what comes next, right? So, like, where are they right now? What do we know about pedagogy that helps us guide them to that next point in time? How are we using technology strategically? That's another one of our structures as well, because as we all know, there were 9 million free things on the internet that were suddenly available to educators, but those weren't necessarily the best things all the time. And so how do we use those couple of key pieces? And for anyone that's read Katie and my work, you know that we're always like, less is more, find a couple good tools, let it rinse, repeat. And so really looking for those opportunities where we can get a lot of bang for our buck, and in doing so, grow kids that are more independent and more agent. You know, like that's been a big piece of this learning from home process. How can we get kids to a point where they can go about their work and make good choices for how they want to show what they know, access the tools that are put in front of them, and really be that chief thinker and learner as they needed to be?
And that student independence piece is so important. I think that that has been a topic of conversation among parents, certainly suddenly realizing that they're not going to be able to just sit their child at the computer while they, you know, do their work and their child just, you know, does their own work. And so we need to think about, as teachers, how are we setting our kids up for success? How are we empowering them to be independent with the tools that we're giving them? And I think we do a lot of that work already. You know, when in September, you think about those first few weeks of school, all we do is work on routines and structures and how do you sit on the carpet and how do you line up? And that's not any different. If we're in the fall in a digital classroom, we'll have to still establish those same routines and same structures. They look very different. But in many ways, they're still the same. So we have to take that time to really build that independence and that efficacy among students.
And I think something that we're seeing as a trend right now, too, is like we've always said we're not just educating like the child, but the family and the community. But now we're in a position where we really are looking at the needs of the family and the community. And we've got a great piece on our distance learning website just for supports for families, you know, and giving, helping families see that sometimes kids need that wait time when they're working online too, and to pause and say, well, how do you think you should go about this? You know, like we don't always have to jump in and help them. And I know sometimes for teachers, that's an inclination too, but if we give kids some structure and then let them muddle through it for a little bit, it imprints in their brain differently, and then they remember how to go about that process the next time they have a go with it. And so I think as we're looking at what this looks like moving forward, it's going to take a lot of parent education as well. I also think we're looking at schools to expand what they're offering families at such a deeper level. Are we also providing our families mental health services, resources for housing and food, and, you know, all of those wraparound pieces that many families are lacking at this moment in time? So the definition, I think, of school and community has really amplified in the last couple weeks.
Yeah, I think those are all really great points about thinking of the different ends of this and thinking about educating families and educating teachers, because I think that educating teachers on the structures to provide really that helps one side of it, and then helping families to understand that you don't have to solve the problem for them right away, which isn't a natural, necessarily, it's not a natural skill necessarily, that everyone has. It's something that teachers practice every day. So what we're thinking about the summer, what are some things we should consider as we plan over the summer? What can we plan for that would help in any scenario?
I think the first thing we have to do is we really need to take a good hard look at our curriculum, and we need to simplify, right? Because I think we've seen that with this whole distance e-learning that it's taking kids longer to get through things, and we could really look at it in a much different way, right? We could look at it as more of a study of depth as opposed to coverage, and I think that's a really important mindset to take into any curriculum planning, to release ourselves from trying to get through so much and race through all the content and get all the facts and think about what is important for kids to really know right here and right now, right? We want them to be able to think critically. We want them to still carry forward being readers and mathematicians and scientists. So how can we accomplish that? What needs to change in our curriculum or shift in our curriculum to make that happen with what our students might be working with at home or at school? I think another piece is that there's a lot of unknown. I know that some districts are already saying what it's going to look like in the fall, whereas other districts are really examining, 15, 20 different possible scenarios. So we have to think about, if I'm going to look at a unit plan or a unit of study or whatever it is that I have in my district, I need to look at that with a couple different lenses. Most of all, being adaptive, right? If I'm adaptable, if I'm flexible, then I can see, okay, if we're in a hybrid model, these are the things that I would really want to teach face-to-face because I need to maximize that personal connection time. These are the things that could be taught digitally, right? These are more practice. If it's all distance learning or e-learning, then what needs to shift or change so that kids can still access this without having that teacher sitting right next to them?
Mm-hmm. I think one of the big things that I would caution schools not to do, and what I hear rumblings of from different places that I work with across the country, is we just can't take what we did in a physical building and put it on a digital tool and say, you go to PE from 8:41 until 9:32, and then you have a 10-minute break, and then you go to English. Because it doesn't work like that. You know, like, that's doing a disservice to students as well as to the curriculum and the tools, because we can do better than that for kids. And I think of it a lot under the umbrella of like reading fluency, right? We teach our mini lessons, but then we know the most important thing is that we give kids time to practice, go doing the work in order to build that fluency. Same with math, same with everything, right? So if we're just requiring them to physically be in a Google Meet or a Zoom during regular school hours, that's not exactly what they need. And that's not the best use of our time or the best use of their time. And so especially in the elementary grades, I think more of an interdisciplinary approach, I think it's an opportunity for us to give kids choice and how they go about these processes. You know, like, yes, we're talking about informational reading and writing, but under that, like, what will you research? Which sites will you select? How will you pull together your findings and share it with the group? So we do have a lot of opportunities, I think a lot of it starts with the streamlining, as Katie said. And then I think the other big thing we really need to take a look at is well-being and social emotional learning. That's going to be a huge piece for us going back to school. For the simple fact, baseline, in addition to many others, that we've never been apart from kids for five and a half, 6 months before. You know, and so reestablishing that culture as a staff, reestablishing that culture with students, reestablishing that with families is going to be a whole other thing. Add on to that some of the challenges that students have been faced with COVID-19, whether it be health, jobs,
security, stability, any of those pieces. And so we're going to have to really make time for that. I think so many schools, and like this is another win, so many schools have done such a great job of finding time for well-being and social emotional support in this digital context. I hope that we value it in the same way when we go back to school buildings and do have more of that traditional structure, because we know that like the emotional piece is really the foundation for everything we do next.
I agree with all that, Kristen. And I think something that we can really focus on is realizing that we will need to give our students tools, more tools in their toolbox than they already have. And I think that probably goes for families and for our teachers as well, right? For ourselves, we need more tools in our toolbox. You cannot build a house with a wrench. You need a lot of tools. So we have to really focus on that starting from the get-go. And that being said, that will take time. And so what then goes, or how are we integrating that? You know, I think there's a lot of different ways you can approach it. But we have to remember that a lot of the social emotional, awareness that can be gained through story and weaving that with stories and bringing those characters to life and then tying that with those real world skills and strategies and actions. I think that that can really anchor some kids and give them a sense of, okay, it worked for this character. It can work for me, right? We do a lot of that like bibliotherapy. Mm-hmm.
The literature will be important, as always.
Always. Always.
Yeah, I agree.
And I think, too, Kristen, something you said, it made me think of a meme that I saw, which was, you know, the educating the parents piece. A lot of the asynchronous, which is when you're recording videos, or even the synchronous when you're doing something mm-hmm. live like this, our parents are getting this window into instruction now. And I know that that's an uncomfortable place for a lot of educators. It's something we've had to kind of lean into, but it's a real benefit in some areas. You know, when you think about an area like mathematics, Kristen and I are mostly literacy, but my coaching partner is a math aficionado. So I learned so much from her. And I think that, you know, our kids who are going to school now understand math. It's such a deeper level than we did as kids. And so I saw this meme and it was like, well, you're about to get a whole generation of kids who are going to learn to carry the one again, because that's how parents learn to do it.
Right.
We have this opportunity for them to listen in on the sides mm-hmm. and to get some of that learning alongside their students. Now, I want to say that with a caveat, not everyone can do that. That is, again, a place of privilege to be able to do that. So if that is our goal, we have to make sure that we're setting up structures that all parents have access to, mm-hmm. to that learning, right? Whatever that looks like for your community.
Well, and I think...
Or whoever is there with kids.
Well, and I think if we're, you know, like if we are going to like really talk about equity and look at that digital piece, this is, again, just everything that we know, we need to be equitable in our internet distribution, in our access, in our device distribution within schools. And for the simple reason of if there isn't a adult that is available, there is a virtual adult that is available. And just the safety and security and support that that can provide means so much to so many children who might not have access right now. And, you know, that could really be that tipping point for some types of learners.
Yeah, and you know, actually hearing all of this conversation about families, there I've seen a couple of comments pop up in the right, and I'd like to share them with you if I could. Margaret B. notes that she's been spending a lot of time demystifying the educational process to parents and is thinking about how can she encourage her parents to be her educational partner if they don't have an educational background.
I love that. I think there's a lot of ways to answer that question, but the first thing that pops to my mind is the power of language and the power of how what we say to a kid in a moment has the power to either spark that learning piece, right, or do it for them or shut it down. And so I think modeling more of that coaching language for parents. If, you know, if you are have the ability to still do some conferring with kids or small groups, even inviting parents to sit alongside and say, just sit outside the camera and listen in. And you know, think about the language that we use to prompt kid, or if you're sort of, you know, troubleshooting with a parent, right? And I know I was working with one teacher, and you know, that we were really struggling to help the student be independent. And so we just did a little bit of focus on language, like what's some language that prompts that kid to get back without having someone do it for them. You know, it was almost like a little scientific study. So that's the first thing that kind of comes to my mind, just that prompting language, like, you can do this, like, let's get started, you know, just.
Well, and I think as an early years teacher, just the power of visual supports too, you know, like one of our pre-Ks, we just like sent home via the old fashioned mail and a letter that the family could tape to their wall to teach pre-kindergarten how to do seesaw for the first couple of times. Is onboarding pre-K to seesaw from a distance like the best option ever? No, but it was the option that we chose, and it actually went really well. But like, we know kids need visual supports. Let's give them multiple places. So even if our four-year-olds can look and be like, oh yeah, green plus, right? Then pick my tool. They can then find some level of independence where we can see like, okay, if they can do that, what other visual supports might help them in the home? And even little things as simple as, I'm again thinking pre-K, like we did scavenger hunts for math counts, you know, and like how many of this, how many of this? There's many ways that we can support that and then share that with families, because for the most part, families do want to be supportive and they are the first teachers. So we need to respect that.
And listening, I really envision the beginning of next year looking like a lot more, you know, family conversations like this, and just listening to whatever families want to share. And, you know, not every family may want to share what's happening or their situation, but many of them do. And I think just really understanding where they're coming from and what their hopes and dreams are for their kids, mm-hmm. and what they'd like to see happen. I think that goes a long way towards building that partnership. Anytime that we can, you know, invite parents to speak about their child and kind of share that expertise, I think that sends a message to them that we acknowledge what Kristen is saying. We acknowledge you. I see you as this child's first teacher. I am one of many teachers that they will encounter along their journey, but you are the constant teacher. Mm-hmm.
And I even think like those conversations, if we can, should be happening now, because they will inform whatever we do next, right? And like, we need our families to give us feedback on just any bit of this, because we've never done it before.
Yeah.
These are all such great points. I'm hearing, you know, visuals for students. I'm hearing communication, listening to families and listening to them now. And I think this is such a great conversation, because these are the pieces we need to hear right now. So many people are stuck on how do I use this tool and how do I organize this and that? And it's getting away from the relationships. And there was a question a little bit ago from Jennifer, and Jennifer says, I'm worried about teachers building relationships in the fall with a new group. We had the luxury of already having relationships in place before the pandemic, and I'm wondering if you have any thinking on that.
Yeah, I think there's lots of conversation about this right now, all across the world. You know, like, that's the one thing. It's not just us, like, literally everybody is in this together. Lots of conversations about possibly looping with students, conversations about school being in shifts, right? So like, there might be a Monday, Tuesday group and a Thursday, Friday group, and the rest might be digitally. So when we're thinking about like different tracks, figuring out how we can get in front of students. There's also a lot of conversation about younger students being in the classrooms, because we know how critical that childcare piece has become for families who are trying to work at home. And then maybe middle school and high school would be more virtually, so that we could physically distance kids in school. So there are tons of minds smarter than ours working on this right now, but some of it's going to play out over points in time. But I think if we are starting, you know, from a distance, so much of that, you know, video to get started, so much of sharing ourselves and our stories. And I think we will be able to build relationships from a distance, but we're just going to have to be really creative and thoughtful on how we do that.
Yeah. And I think our time allocation, you know, when we're thinking about what we're doing in a synchronous manner, right, where there's this two-way line of communication versus what I'm doing asynchronously, I'm going to be spending my synchronous capital getting to know kids and building relationships, building community with them and among them. And that's going to look like, you know, some casual chatter. Like, not everything has to be so strict and structured. I know that a lot of the teachers that I've talked to in the district where I work have said that they have found a real benefit in whatever platforms they're using, having some kind of place for kids to just chatter, whether it's a hangout or a specific, you know, LMS chat or whatever. And it, of course, you know, school guidelines and district guidelines still apply as far as being respectful and you know, not not bullying and things like that. But there's no teacher controlling the talk. They're posting pictures of their dog, and they're, you know, they're just sharing that banter that kids have in order to get to know one another and build that community. So I'm going to be spending all my face-to-face time really just building that community, but giving that to them as well, so that they can have that. Now, that being said, they haven't done that before. We have to teach them how, right? Like,
correct.
We have to teach everything. And I think that that's, that was something that we didn't get the benefit of right now, because it was one of these situations where, like, okay, school's closing in 48 right. hours. So
no runway.
Hurry up and panic.
Yeah.
But we do have the benefit of being able to plan and prepare now. And so we'll be able to think about, okay, how am I going to roll this out? How am I going to teach them this tool first? Mm-hmm. How am I going to make sure that they're set up for success with these things before we start the learning process, as opposed to kind of dropping in and saying, okay, we got to learn now, because that's not the way that we would do it if we were starting at the beginning of the year.
I think those are all excellent points. And I think, you know, that's like the first phase, right? The next phase would be like, we go back to school, but then have an interruption. So the other thing we're thinking about too, is what comes as a priority those first 4 weeks, you know, like, what's that first month in terms of collaboration, digital tools, routines, in the event that we're thinking about, what if this happens again?
And I would say in that scenario, it's even more critical to spend additional time on building those SEL tools for your toolbox, priming the kids for flexibility and adaptability, spending extra time really getting to understand what their situation is, so that as an instructor, you can best support them how, you know, the best way that you can, if that distance happens again. Because I think that, you know, some kids do really well with it. Some kids don't. Some kids ebb and flow. I could speak to my own experience some days. And my child's teacher is lovely, and she does these amazing meetings with the kids, and they talk to each other. And, you know, and some days she's so into it, and other days she's like there. And then, you know, another day I caught her, she finally decided she's going to be a chapter book reader. So I caught her like sneakily, you know, she's got Zoom open, but she's like reading down here just out of the field, and part of me was like, cut it out, and the other part of me was like, I'm so proud.
So was a sneaky reader, so true confession of a sneaky reader. It just looks
like if you're going to ignore your teacher, reading a book is the best way to do it. So I think that, you know, it's just fatigue. Like, they just get fatigued. And so being mindful of what that looks like and figuring out how do we still make progress without being so worried about making progress because, you know, progress according to who? Like, according to whose measure? I don't know.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
That's another tangent I could go on.
We'll have to talk about that again another day for sure. Because I think that, you know, just thinking back of all of the things that both of you have noted, I'm hearing relationships, I'm hearing listening, I'm hearing depth over coverage. And, you know, Kristen, you talked earlier about opportunities. And so, you know, when we can all take a breath and give ourselves a time to recover from everything that just happened, because I honestly think even if you knew how to do this on the surface level, the crisis point of everything just made it really hard to access your own skills, I think, for a lot of people. And so, you know, when we do come back to this, we can start to see these as more opportunities. And so I don't know if there's any other opportunities that you want to highlight that you're thinking of.
Yeah, I mean, I just think as with everything, right, there's another side to that story. And, like, part of the side of this story is that, like, we're using digital tools with kids and in most cases doing at least something really well with students. You know, we now have the opportunity to capture feedback from students in a whole nother way. We also have these great ways to differentiate and truly personalize learning for kids that we might not have accessed before. I was talking with one of my colleagues at a food distribution last weekend, and she said, you know, like, now I just actually know all the different ways I can differentiate for kids to make the learning so much more powerful. And so I think, you know, we're looking at a place where we're hearing kids' stories more just by nature of the multimedia. We're capturing it to either inform or share with the world, right? Like, inform our instruction or inform families. And now, by leveraging some of the new resources that we have, the world is truly at students' fingertips. And that's exciting and motivating, and they can pursue their passions and interests. And, like, that's what Katie and I were talking about when we've been talking about Read the World for the last couple of years prior to the book coming out. It's about, like, yes and, right? It's not about, like, replication or replacement, but it's about we're going to hold on to these great pedagogical pieces and think about how we can add all these other things to our repertoire that makes it even better.
Yeah, and I think that's really come to the forefront because it is hard to stay engaged through a screen all day, every day, when who knows what is going on around you. So we can't just, you know, we have to bring our A game, and that doesn't mean that kids need flash and dazzle, but they need substance. They need to have a sense of connection. They need to have a sense of an authentic audience. They need to have that opportunity to have some choice with what they're working on. I think some other pieces is, you know, looking at the amount of time we're spending on things. Something that I'm noticing is that we need to, like, teach in cycles, and those cycles need to be shortened. You cannot let a unit go for 4 or 5 weeks because you've lost everyone by the end of week two. You know, maybe you can do week three. So thinking about how do we get to depth while at the same time shortening that cycle, right? And what does that look like? And I think that that's a really interesting question to anchor conversations for this summer. Like, what does that look like? And are we cycling back to things? Or does that mean that, you know, if we're looking at informational reading skills, are we finding a way to make it fresh each week, right? Am I launching informational reading with media and images and video? And then the next week I'm, like, looking at infographics, and then we're getting into text. You know, I think there's ways that we can keep it fresh with what we're doing to keep kids engaged and keep them interested But that piece about choice and work that means something to them, that's something that, if you want to talk about what do kids need right now, that's a skill that carries them beyond this year. It carries them beyond the pandemic. It carries them into life. And it equips them to be those learners and thinkers that we really want.
And that's exactly what schools should be, right? Like, it shouldn't be about like acing the test or like check boxes of standards crossed off. It's about how are we preparing them for living? And this is where we have to be really open-minded over the summer, because living is shifting, and it has been for a number of years, not quite like what we're experiencing now, but like we need to be forward thinking in this. I think the other piece that has to be addressed, and this is probably its whole nother Facebook Live, but assessment and feedback for kids versus grading, and like really looking at, so many times I've heard conversations from teachers around the country about, but I have to put in grades. So that's informing what they're doing with digital learning, which is then the number of grades is hindering the opportunity to seek research, think deeply, converse, collaborate, and share with authentic audiences. So I think lots of conversations up ahead that are going to be tricky, but I think if we address them, we'll come out a lot better on the other side and more prepared and just be doing a better job for our students.
Yeah, this is a great conversation. I really needed this as much as maybe everyone listening. So it's been so wonderful. Okay. And, I think, just to kind of close us out for tonight, and I made a few notes for some possible future conversations, like the one you just mentioned, because there are a lot more conversations to be had to get us going in the right direction. But you've named a lot of things that are really important, but just kind of summing up at this point, your top recommendations. So districts are in conversation right now, trying to craft a distance learning plan that's flexible. And what would you say are the top things to think of and then work through from there?
Question. You go first.
I have so many things. Yeah, there are so many things about this. I think first and foremost, like, districts have to figure out the equity piece. What does this look like? When we say all learners, what do we mean by all learners? And so addressing that in whatever way, shape, or form that we can, piece one. I think piece two needs to be on well-being and social emotional learning. It is Mental Health Awareness Month. So it's a great time to start or seed some of these conversations. But that's something we've been needing to talk about for years. COVID has just highlighted it. So this is something, as we're all coming back together, we're taking another look at and
Okay, everyone. Well, thank you so much for joining us. We're having a little bit of an audio issue. It just cut out for a moment, but thank you everyone so much for joining us. We will be sure to have more conversations with Kristen Zimke and Katie Moutaris because they have a lot to share, and we are really looking forward to talking more about their insights. So please check out Read the World and Amplify if you have not seen their books yet, and check out the Heinemann blog and Heinemann podcast for more more learning with them. So thanks again, everyone, for joining us, and Katie and Kristen for your time. We really appreciate it. All right. Bye, everyone.